Good evening, surgeons. Tonight, the live stream broadcast lecture is on the topic of total mesorectal excision of the rectum, as well as abdominal perineal resection. this talk today may be a little bit over an hour. It's a bit of a long topic, and I've got two very good videos, which are a little bit on the long side, so we may just go over 8 o'clock. I will try to go as quickly as possible. I just wanted to apologize for the last couple of weeks. I was on leave, and then I had some scheduling conflicts, and I was unable to run the broadcast, I think, the last two Wednesdays, so I think we should be back on track now. The FCS written exams are next week. So everyone is probably a little bit tense, those candidates who are sitting for the exams. All the best to all of you who are writing. And let's just get on with this topic now. So an APR is basically a combination of TMRE plus the perineal dissection. And there's an additional procedure which has been described as the extralevator abdominal perineal resection, and there is also an extended extralevator perineal abdominal perineal resection, and this just has to do with the dissection margin around the anal canal and distal rectum. So the typical standard APR gives you this gooseneck, because the levators come in here just at the junction of the rectum and the anal canal, and it creates a narrowing at this point in the specimen, in the excision specimen. The extralevator excision is the white line, which tends to be more conical or cylindrical on both sides, and the specimen looks more like a cone, which is gently tapering towards the anal canal. The extended extralevator is a more extensive incision. Both the extralevator and extended extralevator includes removal of the levator ani diaphragm, as it were, that three-dimensional complex structure, which is very important for keeping the contents of the pelvis elevated and in place. So the extralevator and extended extralevator excisions requires the excision of the levator ani muscle in its entirety. And this leaves obviously a large defect. We will look at the closure of that defect in one of the videos that I'll show you later. But it's important to actually understand the differences in the extent of the abdominal perineal resection. Okay, now, colorectal surgery, the TMRE in particular, is all based on this description of this total mesorectal excision, which was described by a surgeon in the United Kingdom, Dr. Heald, who is actually still alive today. They've done a lot of work in colorectal surgery, and what was important here is that there's a great difference between the method of colorectal, or the method of anterior resection of the rectum, prior to the advent of Heald's mesorectal excision, or the description that he gave. And since then, which is now coming up to almost 40 years ago, the anterior resections are all done using this method. The older method would just be a more of a blunt dissection, and surgeons would basically put their hand posterior to the rectum and just scoop everything out bluntly, and that has all changed completely because of the work done by Heald and his team in the United Kingdom. This article is available. I will upload it to the teachable.com website. It's not an essential read. You're not going to need to cite this article in your paper, for example, so don't rush to try and read it now. But in terms of preparation for the operative viva, which will be coming up in October, if you are preparing for this exam, and this is a good paper to read just to understand what this holy plane of rectal surgery is all about. Okay, so going into more detail about TME or TMRE principles, the can anyone give me a few principles? I've already alluded to sharp dissection, that's one of them. On WhatsApp, on the WhatsApp group, or individually, can you all maybe just give me some idea of what your understanding of the TMRE principles are? I'll give everyone a minute to respond. Principles of TMRE. Anyone? I don't have too much of time. I don't know if anyone's typing, but I'm going to need to proceed. So basically, we have to remove with the rectum, we have to remove the surrounding connective tissue, which contains fat as well as, very importantly, lymph nodes. And this is described as being the mesorectum or mesentery of the rectum. We do this dissection under direct vision. Heald's description 40 to 50 years ago was using obviously open surgery, and there were a number of specialized retractors that were developed specifically for this purpose. The retractors, I'll show you a picture of it later, actually had light sources built into them, and this allowed better vision because particularly in the male pelvis it tends to narrow down significantly, and that makes the dissection difficult. More recently, with the advent of laparoscopic surgery and even robotic surgery, the telescope is excellent. It gives light right into the area that you're looking at. And the picture is obviously up to 10 times magnified, high definition. So that certainly helps with the dissection. Not to say that the procedure cannot be done open. It's still done as an open procedure in many parts of the world. Right, I alluded to sharp dissection. We no longer go through with blunt dissection using our fingertips. We actually use sharp dissection and carefully separate out the mesorectum from the surrounding tissues. There is an avascular plane that must be sought out, and it's very important to remain in this avascular plane. We'll discuss this in more detail. And it's very important that the specimen comes out with an intact fascial envelope. And this avoids tumor spill and actually improves the 5-year survival, and the locoregional control is much better. Then very importantly, it's important to, it's essential to identify the nerves, the autonomic nerves, both sympathetic and parasympathetic, for bladder and sexual function. And also sphincter preservation, although this is not always possible. Okay, so these are the principles of TMRE. Please know these very well, particularly for your operative viva, and understand this lecture will actually go into more detail of these steps. Okay, just briefly, the elements of the technique: left pelvic exposure, the sigmoid and the left side of the colon are mobilized. The ureters, the left ureters identified, as well as the sympathetic nerves running down over the common iliacs and into the pelvis. The splenic flexure higher up on the left upper quadrant is mobilized to bring the left colon down. The colon is divided, and the vascular pedicle, which is the inferior mesenteric artery, is transected and ligated. Inferior mesenteric vein may be taken at two points, first lower down to improve mobility, and then further dissection as you come up to the DJ flexure. The inferior mesenteric vein may be ligated again, and this allows for better mobility of the left colon and allows you to bring it down into the lower pelvis for a colorectal, low colorectal anastomosis, or possibly even a coloanal anastomosis. The sympathetic nerves must be carefully identified and preserved, and the rectum, once the transection, the colon is transected, the left colon is actually retracted anteriorly over the anterior aspect of the pubic symphysis. And lastly, we penetrate valdes fascia and mobilize the posterior rectum, and this gives us length. Okay, I've got another slide that explains that better. So this is a little bit more about the posterior dissection, but sorry, before we get to that, on now the same colon, sigmoid colon and rectum, is dissected on its right aspect, and the right ureter and sympathetic nerves are identified and preserved. Then as we go down into the pelvis, there's a very important posterior dissection in the rectosacral space, and this is where we dissect through valdes fascia. The image on the left shows the anterior dissection in woman. The uterus and ovaries are anterior to the rectum, and the pouch of Douglas is where the Denon villiers fascia is found, and this is dissected to get a clear anterior margin. The male patient, Denon villiers fascia is closely opposed to the seminal vesicles and the prostate, and very importantly, the parasympathetic nerve plexuses, nervi arrigentes, which are responsible for erectile function in men, are right here. And it is very important to very carefully separate these nerves out and to avoid any damage to them. Otherwise, the patient may have erectile dysfunction postoperatively. Okay, so in this image, what we're looking at here is the rectum posteriorly, anterior to the rectum. We are dissecting right on the prostate and the seminal vesicles. And is a very delicate area that requires a lot of care and attention. Okay, then once we've finished anteriorly and posteriorly, there are lateral stalks, and these are vascular stalks which also contain nerves. Once again, important not to go too far laterally, otherwise there's a risk of damage to the parasympathetic nerves. The lateral pedicles may be transected using a number of instruments, laparoscopic linear vascular stapler, bipolar cautery, vessel sealing devices such as harmonic scalpel or LigaSure device. but the most important thing is to avoid the nerve damage. But at the same time, you must get adequate clearance around the tumor and take out an adequate amount of mesorectum. Guys, if there's any questions, please post them to WhatsApp. Okay, this is just an image showing a laparoscopic vascular stapler being used to take the lateral stalks. Okay, once we are done, so this is now a TMRE with a low anterior resection of the rectum. What we are doing here is showing how using a circular stapler, the low coloanal or colorectal anastomosis is performed. The advent of the modern day circular stapler has allowed us to actually do very low anastomoses, what has been described as an ultra low coloanal anastomosis. This would be virtually impossible using hands-on technique. And it's important that you guys are aware of how these staplers work. They are very useful devices. Importantly, when you are pushing in the stapler per rectum, you shouldn't push the tip of the stapler. It has a sharp tip which pierces this colon or the rectal stump, anal stump. It's important not to push it through the suture line, but to either push it anterior or posterior to that suture line. The anvil, this part is able to separate from the stapler, is the anvil. It's put into the distal colon here. You just, before transecting, or if you've transected with a stapler, you would need to make another enterotomy. Pop the anvil inside the colon. It has a plastic sharp tip which allows you to pierce the colon, and then the plastic part comes off, leaving a female metallic opening which you can then connect to the sharp point of the distal component of the stapler. In this image here, what is shown is a coloplasty rectal pouch. And in this instance, the colon is stapled. It is then a J pouch is created. Enterotomy is created here. This two inner walls would have been stapled with a linear stapler, linear cutting stapler. The enterotomy is already present. The anvil would be popped inside, and a purse string suture would be used to close the colon around the anvil. The anvil would then be connected to the distal part or the pin of the stapler. The two ends, by turning the stapler closed, would bring the two edges together. And then after appropriately checking, the stapler would be fired and then loosened 1.5 turns, and then gently wiggled out the rectum. And you would then open the stapler to check that the donuts, you get donuts from here and from the distal rectum or anus, and it's very important to check that those donuts are complete. Complete donuts suggest that your staple line is complete. Okay, the completion of the TMRE procedure, we need to check that there's no leakage at the anastomotic site. You would put saline into the pelvis, apply a clamp or pressure above the anastomosis, and then insufflate air per rectum and check that there are no bubbles. That would confirm that the anastomosis is secure and intact. A very gentle rectal examination may be done. You can also do a proctoscopy or a rigid sigmoidoscopy to carefully inspect the inner aspect or the mucosal aspect of the anastomosis. You may consider using a drain and diverting ileostomy is to be considered. The specimen assessment is very important. Heald, in his paper, described the TMRE operation as being a specimen-orientated operation, which means that you must carefully inspect your specimen post-operatively, and we will come to that in a little bit later on. We have some pictures of what the specimen should look like. Just a question This is a coronal section MRI. Just a clue, this is the left ischial tuberosity, right ischial tuberosity here. And what are the labels T, L, I, and E? Right, if you can please type an answer to me directly or on the group. I'll give everyone a minute to respond, or 30 seconds, we're a bit short of time. Don't seem to have too many responses today. Okay, I'll go on. Okay, in-depth understanding of TMRE. There are three very important components of this operation that must be very carefully considered and carefully adhered to. Firstly, the description of the holy plane of rectal surgery. The whole rectum and mesorectum are one distinct lymphovascular entity, and the removal of the rectum with the mesorectum improves the outcome in these patients. So this is what the understanding of the holy plane of rectal surgery is, and that basically means that you must do the operation in a very clearly defined plane, and it must include the mesorectum with an intact fascial sheet. Right? The fascial sheet should not be broken. Okay. Got some answers. Yes, T is tumor. Okay, we'll get to that, back to that just now. The other three components are the preservation of the pelvic autonomic nerves, the fascial structures and dissection of the anterior Denon-Villiers fascia, the posterior Valdez fascia, and the last component is the pelvic floor or supralevator fascia. Okay, let's just go back to that question. So the T is the tumor, that's correct. L is the levator ani, I is the internal sphincter, anal sphincter, and E is the external sphincter. Okay, good. And someone with some good answers there. Okay, so starting with the issue of the nerve plexuses, the nerve damage results in quality of life issues, sexual and bladder dysfunction, dyspareunia, failure to achieve orgasm, loss of vaginal lubrication in female patients, male patients, erectile dysfunction, retrograde ejaculation, and impotence. Then you can have problems with bladder emptying, urgency incontinence, loss of sensation, etc. And the TME has a much lower incidence of these complications compared to the historical cases. And that's because we try and stay very carefully in the correct plane. Here, this diagram just shows the different plexuses, the hypogastric nerve coming down over the common iliacs. And then there are, that's sympathetic innervation. And then the parasympathetic innervation is coming from the lateral wall, from the sacral nerves. The plane of dissection is shown here in red, and as you can see, it remains outside, or better description would be inside of all the nerve plexuses, right? And this is really your holy plane of rectal surgery. Okay, so let's start with the pelvic nerves, the sympathetic nerves. People commonly believe that the nerves are injured as they come over the common iliacs in this region here. But if you stay out of the fascia or the connective tissue surrounding the common iliacs, these nerves can be easily preserved. The nerves themselves run relatively close to the lateral pelvic wall. However, when you are actually retracting the rectum with the mesorectum and you're dissecting in this area, the danger is that you can actually pull the lateral sympathetic nerves into your plane of dissection. And this causes or puts these nerves at risk when you are sharply dissecting in this area. So this is very careful to avoid. And the bloodless or avascular plane, there are actually two planes, and unfortunately one of these planes is inside the inferior hypogastric plexus. And if you get into this plane and you think you're doing very well, it's all avascular, you may run into trouble because you can't transect the nerves. So you very carefully need to identify this plane that is actually outside the hypogastric nerve plexus and stay outside as opposed to inside. Okay, going on to the parasympathetic nerve plexuses. There are two areas where these can be damaged. Just to orientate yourself, this is the sacrum here, pelvic bones laterally, this is the rectum, and this is this big mesorectum that we are resecting. The pelvic nerves on the lateral aspect can be damaged, and also on the anterolateral aspect, and this is very important, as I mentioned earlier, the close association of the male patient with the seminal vesicles, right, and the damage to these anterior parasympathetic nerves, the nervi irrigentes, can lead to multiple sexual dysfunctions in the male patient. Okay. So going on to Denon-Villiers fascia, we've finished with the nerves. Remember I said that we're going to discuss nerves, fascia, and then the levator ana. So we've done with the nerves, now we're moving on to the fascia. The anterior fascia, shown in this image in purple, is the Denon-Villiers fascia. In the male patient, this is between the rectum and the prostate and seminal vesicles anteriorly, rectum posteriorly. And in the female patient, this is between the rectum posteriorly and the distal uterus and vault of the vagina, and in the female patient. Denon-Villiers is far better appreciated in the male patient, as described in association with the seminal vesicles. The other fascia that's shown here is the presacral or Valdes fascia, then the pelvic nerve plexuses that should be avoided, and the hypogastric sacral sympathetic nerves. Just to give you an idea of the operative view, in the benign patient, or patient with benign disease, I should say, you can stay posterior to Denon-Villiers, close to the rectum, and that will give you an adequate clearance because there's no tumor spread to concern yourself with. If, however, it is malignant disease, you've got to dissect anterior to Denon-Villiers and remove it with the specimen, which is a slightly wider dissection margin, very subtle, as you can see from there to there. Okay, then the Denon-Villiers fascia, just to understand that you stay very close to the posterior aspect of the bladder, prostate, and seminal vesicles. and the difference in the dissection or direction of dissection for benign versus malignant disease. Sorry, that image is not too clear. Now, what is important to understand is that the Denon Villiers fascia must be resected with the specimen. You don't actually leave the Denon Villiers in place. It comes away with the specimen. And to do this, you actually have to resect this little cul-de-sac of peritoneum. This, in a female patient, would basically be the pouch of Douglas. And here you can see that if it is properly dissected out, you see a lovely sharp line between the intraperitoneal and extraperitoneal components of the rectum. And if you take out Denon Villiers fascia adequately, you will actually be able to slip a finger into that pouch. In the male patient, that would be just posterior to the prostate, and in the female patient, this would be the pouch of Douglas. Okay, to remember that when you are dissecting Denon Villiers fascia, not only is the seminal vesicle and the nerves at risk, but the left and right ureters are also very close by, and you've got to be very careful with your dissection in this area. This picture here is an operative picture, open surgery. This is a retractor that's placed on the pubic symphysis, and you can see this is actually a light source here. The reason for showing this image is to show you this area here, which corresponds with the schematic, this slight bulge. This is what you've got to be careful of. In the male patient, the seminal vesicle with the nerves, you've got to be very careful to identify and preserve that. Okay, then Valdez fascia. What is Valdez fascia? It's basically a connective tissue layer that it makes the posterior aspect of the rectum adherent to the sacrum, so it's a sort of rectosacral fascia. Right, and it comes from the S3-4 vertebrae. What happens when you transect this fascia? So this fascia, after you've transected it, gives you a lot of mobility of the colon. You are able to pull the colon, the rectum up more into the abdomen and straighten it out, and this gives you a lot of length below the tumor, obviously depending on how low the tumor is, but it gives you some length to work with. All right. And importantly is that it allows you to enter into a bloodless plane in the lower dissection of the distal rectum as you get closer to the levator ani. Okay, this is this lengthening. And you reach Valdez fascia, the tumor which was adherent or stuck down because of the retrosacral fascia is now mobilized, and you get an increase in length from this level to a few centimeters, possibly more. Right. And what does the above steps signify in terms of your further dissection? Once you've penetrated Valdez fascia, you start now moving your dissection more anteriorly instead of following the curve of the sacrum and going posteriorly. You actually start moving your dissection anteriorly towards the rectoanal junction. Okay, so that concludes our discussion of the fascia that must be carefully dissected. And we're now going to move on to our discussion of the pelvic floor and the levator ani muscles. So we should actually think of the pelvic floor as a funnel, and the anus is cradled in the outlet of that funnel. Okay, so this is the funnel created by the levator ani muscles, and this is the anal canal, which is cradled in the outlet of that funnel. Right, the same thing in this image here. There's the levator ani muscles, and here's the anal canal cradled in the funnel. Okay, this is what I mentioned earlier, the specialized retractors for open surgery. They actually have a light source built in, and this light source, using a fiber optic cable, allows better visualization. Then I spoke about a specimen orientated operation, and this is what we were referring to. This is a specimen that is cut at the level of the proximal anal canal, distal rectum, and the bulge of the mesorectum. This is actually the mesorectum, right? Lovely and complete, very nice shiny fascial planes. The planes have not been breached. If you were to look at the posterior aspect I'll show you just now, you get a bilobed appearance, and that's because of the median raphe on the posterior aspect of the rectum, which adheres between the rectum and the sacrum, part of Valdeus fascia. Okay, the specimen from a different view. Right, it's the fascial plane is lovely and smooth. This is the extra peritoneal component. This is the intraperitoneal component. You can see the shiny serosa here. And when we talk about specimen orientated surgery, it is very important to inspect your specimen post-op, take photographs, and actually present your photographs at your unit's meeting. If you are running a colorectal unit, it is essential to run peer review and show that you have done an adequate dissection by showing pictures, images of your dissected or removed specimen. Okay, this is the MRI transverse section of the pelvis, and it actually shows you the holy plane of rectal surgery, right? And that's the specimen that was removed. This is the bilobed posterior aspect of the mesorectum that I mentioned, due to the adherence of the fascia and the median plane to the sacrum posteriorly, and it gives you this bilobed appearance. The other thing to confirm on your specimen, this is the IMA here. There's a nice clear dissection line all the way down to the color of the anorectal transection. Right, and if you move off this line, the risk is damage to nerves. Right, this is just another specimen showing you the clean line once again. Right, going from intraperitoneal to extraperitoneal, and this is that little anterior pouch where the previous picture the surgeon inserted their finger, with Denon Villiers fascia anteriorly having been completely excised. And the mesorectum has a definite end, and this ends at the upper anal margin. Right, just above the levator ani muscles. So what structures are excised in the TMRE? If anyone wants to answer that quickly, what do we actually excise? Just waiting for answers.
Okay, I've got an answer. Rectum. Okay, is someone else answering? Just waiting. Okay, so yes, this is what's resected. Sigmoid, rectum, mesorectum. The distal transection line is the anus, proximal anal canal at the level of the levator ani, and the IMA is transected, and the proximal sigmoid is labeled. Okay. Okay, can anyone tell me why we are compelled to remove the sigmoid? Why are we not able to retain the sigmoid? And you know, very frequently the sigmoid is very mobile, and then you bring the sigmoid down and anastomose it to the distal rectum or proximal anal canal. Okay, so the question is, why does the sigmoid colon have to be resected? Okay, yes, that's great. basically, this is an oncological resection, so you have to follow the blood supply. The blood supply to the rectum is via the superior rectal artery, which is one of the branches of the IMA. Right? The other branch is the left colic, and both of those have to be transected. You transect the IMA and the blood flowing to both the superior rectal and the left colic are sacrificed. Because that blood supply is sacrificed, the main blood supply to the sigmoid is now lost, and the sigmoid will not tolerate that. So you have to remove the sigmoid, and you then bring the proximal sigmoid. You obviously decide at your transection line whether this tissue is viable, or you may need to go higher onto descending colon. And then you will bring that down. Yes, that's a good answer. Someone has said common blood supply with the rectum. Well, not technically common, but because you have to take the IMA, superior rectal artery goes down to the rectum, left colic artery goes up to the sigmoid, so you sacrifice both of those. Good. Okay, so this picture, can anyone tell me what operation is shown here? Okay, this is actually a pelvic exenteration, because what they've done is they've taken out, there's a huge massive tumor here. They've taken out the bladder, the prostate, all the external genitalia are probably involved in the tumor, right? And this is what you're left with, a huge defect, and this is the edges, the levator ani are sitting somewhere there, they're all gone. Somewhere up there, I don't even know, can't even make them out. This is a female patient here. This is the uterus. This is the ovaries. This looks like maybe a bit of the bladder there, and everything is taken out. So this is a pelvic exenteration for advanced rectal CA. Okay, what other organ has been resected with the rectum here? This is actually the prostate in a male patient. It was invaded by the tumor, it cannot be separated, so it was taken out with the rectum. Obviously, in this instance, you are going to have the seminal vesicles and the nervi erigentes coming out as well. So you're going to affect erectile function, etc. What is shown here, this is just the insertion of the anvil through the opening in the proximal colon, and then the application of a linear cutting stapler to transect and seal the proximal end of the colon. Advantages of the TMRE technique: dramatically reduced local recurrence rates, increased survival, decreased incidence of bladder and sexual dysfunction, and very importantly, sphincter preservation. Okay, the operation lines I've already mentioned to you. The standard TMRE or APR resection, where you go close to the anal canal, and the blue line shows the more extensive extended or extra levator abdominal perineal resection. Okay, and the difference in the specimens, the goosenecking here and the conical wider excision in the extra levator abdominal perineal excision. What about closure after this removal of the levators? Right, what is shown here, and I've got a video of this, is a rectal muscle flap is done. The plastic surgeon will be involved, and a rectal muscle flap with its blood supply and musculocutaneous, so it's got skin on it as well, is pulled down through the laparotomy incision and brought out through the defect in the perineum. Right, and then the skin from the anterior abdominal wound is sutured in place, or sutured to the edges of the perineal skin, and this is the final suture line on the anterior abdomen, and then a circumferential suture line where the skin is used to close the defect in the perineum. Okay, if there's any questions, please post them. I'm now going to just show you two videos. Okay, this video is 30 minutes, so I'm not going to show the entire thing. I'm going to just skip through the certain parts of it, the certain things that I want you to see. Thank you. This is the extralevator abdominal perineal resection. This video has narration, but it's very quick. I will stop as we go. And
this video demonstrates our technique for performing an ischioanal extralevator abdominal perineal resection. It is done together with our plastic surgery colleagues. A 54-year-old man developed rectal carcinoma with pelvic sepsis from long-standing fistula in the anal. A colostomy was created and sepsis was controlled. Preoperative MRI revealed a bulky, locally advanced rectal tumor. We discussed at our multidisciplinary team meeting, and subsequently he underwent long-course chemo radiotherapy. Post-neoadjuvant treatment MRI showed decrease in the size of the tumor. We therefore plan to perform an ischioanal extralevator APR for him. For our technique, the patient is placed in a modified Lloyd Davis position and sigmoid colostomy is taken down before laparotomy to avoid contamination of the abdominal cavity. The patient is then re-cleaned and draped before laparotomy. Sigmoid mobilization and inferior mesenteric artery division are performed in the usual manner. Proximal transection is completed. Rectal mobilization to the origins of the levator is performed. To prevent coning of the specimen, mobilization must stop at the insertion of the levator ani instead of the pelvic floor in conventional APR. Anteriorly, we stop at the level of the seminal vesicles. Posteriorly, we stop at the sacrococcygeal junction. Bimanual palpation is performed to identify this landmark. Laterally, we stop when the inferior hypogastric nerves turn anterior laterally. The VREM flap is then harvested together with the plastic surgeons. Intra-abdominal portion of the flap is de-epitalized. The flap is sutured and capped in the plastic bag to prevent seeding of the cancer cells. To assist in retrieval in the perineal phase.
Okay, so just to run through that, they go very quickly in this video. I will upload it to Teachable. And what I suggest you just look at it again. So they've started in the Lloyd Davies position. They've reversed the colostomy that the patient had. They popped it back inside the abdomen. They then proceeded to laparotomy and they did the dissection of the sigmoid colon going down into the pelvis. But because they are doing an extralevator excision, the dissection doesn't have to go all the way down. As we had described in the lecture earlier, what happens is that you actually stop at the level of the seminal vesicles anteriorly, and posteriorly you stop at the sacrococcygeal ligament. The colon was then transected, and the abdomen was then the plastic surgeons were involved. To create the rectus musculocutaneous rectal flap. That flap was put into a plastic bag to prevent tumor contamination. And now what they're doing is they're just using a couple of methods to allow them to identify the specimen and to pull it out through the perineum. They're then going to turn the patient because they operate in the prone jackknife position as opposed to the Lloyd Davies, which we typically operating. Okay, please, if there's any questions.
Please, a gauze is stitched with the colonic stump. The sigmoid stump is brought out through the previous stoma site, and the transabdominal pelvic drain is prepared. This is stitched to the gauze as well to assist in the retrieval later. The flap wrapped in the plastic bag is similarly prepared. All are placed posteriorly in preparation for retrieval through the perineum later. The next step is closure of the abdominal wound and maturation of the sigmoid and colostomy. The perineal phase of the surgery involves repositioning of the patient into the prone position. Operating theatre with split legs is prepared and patient is secured with support at the bony prominences. The patient is now ready to start the perineal phase of surgery. The incision is extended superiorly to the sacrococcygeal junction for better exposure. All prior and existing fistulas with external openings are included in the resection. The skin incision is made and dissection proceeds into the ischioanal fat towards the ischiotuberosity. Once we identify the ischiotuberosity, lateral dissection follows the fascia of the obturatus internus up to the apex of the ischioanal fossa. The apex of the ischioanal fossa is where the levator attaches to the bony pelvis. The same approach is repeated on the right side. Dissection is directed towards the ischiotuberosity and then along the plane of the obturator internus fascia. Dissection of the coccyx and sacrococcygeal joint is performed. Sacrococcygeal junction is transected and the abdominal cavity is entered. The levator ani is detached from the bony origin circumferentially. Energy device is used for better hemostasis. Once the levator is sufficiently divided, the bowel can be exteriorized. The sigmoid stump and drain is removed from the perineum. What is left is the anterior attachments to the prostate. This allows for the anterior dissection of rectum from prostate to be performed under direct vision. You can see that the view is extremely good. It allows us to approach this traditionally difficult part of the dissection through multiple angles. The resection is now completed. This is the final cavity post-resection. The surgical view is broad and you can see the prostate, right seminal vesicle and shiny surface of the obturator internus. The next step is perineal wound closure. The virium flap is retrieved transperineally and the defect is closed. This is the final specimen. From the posterior view, it is very satisfactory. The anterior aspect has very good quality TME. This is the lateral view demonstrating adequate mesenteric length and satisfactory perineal dissection. Final histology returned as mucinous adenocarcinoma with R0 resection. Patient recovered well and is now undergoing adjuvant chemotherapy. This video is...
Okay. It's a very good video. It's a little bit quick, but if you watch it again, it'll make it easier for you to understand. And that brings us to the end of today's lecture. Thanks very much, guys. Not many people watching today. Okay, good night.